All right, let's close out module two. This module's focus was assessment. So in part one, we talked about the different types of assessment that we can use to progress monitor within a DBI framework. In the second part, we focused on the administration and scoring of progress monitoring measures. And finally, we talked about the interpretation of progress monitoring scores, whether to determine if students are responding or not responding. So let's go back and visit Mr. Flores and see if we answered his question.
Okay, I understand that mathematics concepts build upon one another, and I will need to address gaps in understanding. I am also aware that these are some fundamental math skills that my students need to master to continue to make progress. I'm interested in using DBI with my students, but I don't know which assessments to use to make decisions about whether my instruction is working.
So I think we've answered his question. So we talked about using early numeracy assessments for students that aren't adding and subtracting. We talked about using computation measures or concepts and applications measures for students anywhere along the elementary or middle school continuum. So remember in part one, we talked about our DBI framework. We focused on progress monitoring, which can be used to determine how well the intervention is working at this point in the DBI framework. And if we do have to make an adaptation, progress monitoring can be used here to see how well that adaptation is working for the students. We also talked about the diagnostic assessment. So that's used to understand strengths and weaknesses of the student. So in part one, I'd like you to think about how you can use formative assessments to make decisions about whether students are responding or not responding, how you can use those diagnostic assessments to identify strengths and weaknesses, and also how summative assessments can be used to gauge end of year learning. That is really why we're doing all of this, is to make sure students are on track to meet grade level expectations. In part two, we talked a lot about the administration and scoring of assessments. So you need to select progress monitoring measures that are reliable and valid and have alternate forms. You need to be able to administer those with fidelity, and you need to be able to score those and graph the student's scores. That leads us to part three. In part three, we really focused on the response and non-response of students and how to determine whether students are responding or not responding. So there with your checklist, I'd like you to think about setting goals using one of three methods, the benchmark, the slope, or the intra-individual framework, and then making timely decisions about the student's progress using either the four most recent consecutive scores or the student's trend line. Now it's time for you to do your classroom application. I would like you to start or continue doing some type of progress monitoring with your students, and I want you to do that on a weekly basis. I also want you to start or continue graphing data. And then I want you to start or continue making decisions about progress. All of those things we've just talked about in this module, and all of them will help us use this DBI framework. Now, looking ahead to our next module, we have finished module one, where we talked about foundational skills and the scope and sequence for instruction. We just finished module two, talking about progress monitoring and determining response. And now we're gonna head into module three, where we're gonna think about what are the evidence-based practices that we can use to inform the instructional platform. We're gonna kind of go back up here and think, well, we know the mathematical content, but what are the evidence-based practices we can use to teach that content? That's where we're gonna start in module three. We have a reading about locating evidence-based practices. I'll talk about that in module three, and we will see you soon.